How do you build a dinosaur? Yes, you heard that right, dinosaurs. But how do you build something which died 60 million years ago? When we see a paleontologist digging up dinosaurs or see them in the museum, we see bones. But when we see velociraptors running or T-Rexes roaring in movies like Jurassic Park, how exactly do we transform bones into scary, living, breathing, roaring creatures? We're supported today by our rockstar paleontologist, Professor Stuart Samida, who worked on the actual Jurassic World film and helps us understand the question, how do you build an on-screen dino? Dinosaurs have captured our imagination throughout history. Many ancient cultures created myths from dinosaur fossils when they didn't really know what they actually were. The myth about dragons were probably imagined looking at enormous fossilized bones like this one. In the 1800s, we started discovering and studying a lot of large fossils using the then brand new and fast-growing branch of science, paleontology. Early paleontologists started calling these beasts dinosaur, meaning terrible or fearfully great lizard. Though we know now they're not necessarily terrible and they're not even true lizards. England in the late 1800s was mesmerized by these enigmatic beasts. It was quite a sensation when humongous life-sized dinosaurs were built in Crystal Palace in London in the 1850s. It was almost like the first Jurassic Park movie before movies were even a thing. Of course, today we now know most of these depictions were wrong, but you have to give it to them, they worked really hard on creating the details. One of the coolest things about dinosaurs is how big a role they played in the history of film and animation. Possibly the earliest animated character ever was actually Gertie the dinosaur, created in 1914 by artist Winsor McCay. Winsor was an artistic prodigy from a very young age, starting off creating little portraits that he would sell for 25 cents and then later drawing Sunday art and comics on newspapers. Winsor came up with this hugely innovative idea of moving characters on the screen. And when he revealed Gertie the dinosaur, audiences were stunned and the positive reviews kept coming in from critics. So much so that McKay kept releasing new animations instead of working his newspaper job. That was until his boss, the famous newspaper publisher, William Hearst, stopped all reviews of his animation work being published on his newspapers and also forced McKay to sign a contract, stopping him from doing any animations. Fast forward 25 years and we went from Gertie to the iconic The Rite of Spring sequence in Disney's Fantasia. We just need to compare the two side by side to see the enormous advancement and leap in technology. At the same time, famous paleo artist Charles R. Knight's dinosaur sketches inspired many scientists and movie makers. They weren't perfect, but his new style, color, and grace made them look more realistic than Gertie. It was his depiction of Triceratops fighting T-Rex that made them the mortal enemies we think of today. He was a pioneer of using his knowledge of modern animal anatomy in his paintings, and he did this while being legally blind, using special glasses to see. A real, real badass. But wait, how did on-screen dinosaurs change from lumbering, Gertie-like animals to today's lean, mean, intelligent killing machine? Or of course, peaceful, lumbering herbivores. We can see this evolution if you watch the Jurassic Park films. The dinosaurs are obviously much more agile and faster compared to previous dinosaur depictions. That's not an accident. We used to think that dinosaurs were much too big to be agile, but discoveries over the last few decades have showed that this is just not true. In the late 1960s, the famous John Ostrom and his student Rob Backer started pushing the idea that birds came from actual flying dinosaurs, and dinosaurs must have shared a lot of traits to birds. One aspect about birds is that they're agile, while another is that they're quite intelligent. This has meant that over the years, how we think about dinosaurs has gone from slow, lumbering creatures to creatures with bright displays, moving quickly and, in many cases, with a lot of intelligence. This has had an impact on films, where dinosaurs are now presented as intelligent enough to hunt in packs, like in the original Jurassic Park. Sure, these films are still basically monster movies, but there's a lot of science in them, and this relationship and tension between the science and the need to entertain is where the real movie magic happens. But someone has to sit and create these animals, how to visualize them and how to build them in a computer so we can see them on our screens. What does the process of creating each starring dinosaur look like? Well, it all starts with shape. We're not just talking about how it looks, but how it was shaped so it can move on screen in a way that makes sense. At this stage, a concept artist works with a scientist like Professor Stuart Semida to figure the shape out. They then hand it over to someone called a rigger. The rigger takes the shape and sticks a computerized skeleton into our shapely dinosaur. Here, Stuart would help the rigger understand where the joints would be and where the central pivot point would be if the dinosaur needs to move a certain way. The final stage brings our dino to life when this puppet gets given to an animator. An animator has to understand movement very well, and their job is to make the dinosaur act on screen. An animator, therefore, is just an actor. An actor, just one that sits behind the camera. The animator's job is not easy. They have to move through every single scene, bit by bit by bit, to figure out how our dinosaur will move. This stage is critical. You have to get the audience to suspend their disbelief. To do that, scientists work hand in hand with the animator to figure out how the dinosaur will move through both prehistoric as well as modern day environments. Just like Charles R. Knight did, today's animators take a lot from our existing animal world. This sound still sends chills down my spine. Believe it or not, that's actually the sound of a tiger, an alligator, and a baby elephant, all mixed together. The T-Rex's breath is the sound of a whale's blow. When it comes to dinosaurs, what we see on the movie screen coincides with the time the film was made. In many ways, it's a snapshot of the scientific knowledge and animation technologies available at the time. Perhaps in the 22nd century, people will look at Jurassic World and feel the same way we feel about Gertie today. But one thing seems certain, these majestic prehistoric creatures will continue to influence artists, filmmakers, scientists, and people like you and me forever.
If you like our videos, then like and subscribe below.
If you want to hear more about the Jurassic World films, click on the link below for a video of our professor Stuart Semida talking about his work on those films.
The myth about dragons were probably imagined looking at enormous fossilized bones like this one.